Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rahul Bajaj, and I'm working as a software engineer at Broadcom for almost 3 years now. And I'm working as part of DB2's team in developing the CA DB2 tools, or now Broadcom DB2 tools. And now this presentation is all about something that I've used in my previous organizations. It's a SORT utility, and I used it as a beginner in mainframe. So I thought it might be interesting for the beginners in mainframe or Gen Z or whatever we can call it. And the idea behind today's presentation is to develop a basic understanding of DFSort and its processing. And I think the best way to learn DFSort is to keep playing with it. And as a beginner, I ran many DFSort jobs and stuff like that to analyze output files and change the control statements, which I'll cover later in this presentation. And so I thought you will find it interesting. So this is the agenda for today. We'll start with the DFSort and what's the use of DFSort, then how to code DFSort control statements, and then we'll move on to the ICE tool and how to invoke it and how to use the ICE tool operators. We'll have a short sneak into the application programming basics, how to invoke DFSort from a COBOL program, and some tips for improving efficiency, and then these smart DFSort examples, we can do it in form of a demo on mainframe, and then we can take up questions and comments at the end. Or you can poke me around in the middle of the session for questions, it's okay. Okay, so what is DFSort? It's an IBM high-performance sort utility for reporting purposes on ZOS, and with DFSort, we really can play with the data at bit level, field level, or the record level as well. And it improves both application performance in terms of saving CPU time and elapsed time. And also, we can save time by the programmer's time for writing and maintaining those applications. What else you can do with DFSort? So apart from sorting the data sets or copying the data sets, while sorting, we can do a variety of stuff, like selecting a subset of records from input data set. We can include a particular record or omit a particular type of record, and then we can reformat it. And this reformatting feature of DB2, this DFSort, it really gives you powerful capabilities to build your own input record and output record. And then we can sum the numeric values in some selected records while sorting or merging. And we can create multiple output data sets over a single pass to DFSort. Also, there's much more you can do with DFSort. As I said, I'm also a beginner and user in DFSort, so I'm not sure if I've been able to exploit all the features of DFSort still. So there's a long way to go. So this is how we can invoke DFSort. With JSON statement, usually in DFSort application programming guide or getting started with DFSort, you'll see calling DFSort directly. So calling DFSort directly means to a JCL and using the name of the program, which is sort or Iceman. And we can write it in the COBOL, PLI, or assembly language as well, using sort verbs. We'll cover that later in this presentation. And also, we can invoke it from a CList or REX. The key is to specify the allocate statements and then use the address statement in REX to invoke the actual program. Also, there's an ICE tool utility provided by IBM, which is a multi-purpose DFSort utility, and it can be used to provide multiple output files over working with multiple input files as well at the same job level or this step level. So this is a sample DFSort JCL. As you can see, this job statement will signal the beginning of the job, And then this exit statement tells the OS that we need to invoke the df sort. So this PGM can be sort or Iceman, they are one and the same thing. And then we use this out for the df sort messages and control statements to be printed in the job log. And then these sort in and sort out are the input and output data sets respectively. The most important part here is the sysint, where we specify the control statements. We'll learn more about them in coming slides. And additional JCL statements can go after that. So let's move on to the df sort control statements and symbols. So these are the most important control statements which I have used in my experience. First two are the include and omit control statements. Like I said, we can select a subset of records or by including or omitting those on based on a logical criteria. And then we can sum up the numeric fields on based on the some fields that we provide. And also this outrec and inrec provides really powerful capabilities to reformat the input record and also the output record after or before the sorting process or the copy process is completed. The outfill control statement, the as you can see with the name, outfill stands for output file, and we can really do some processing on the output file once all the sorting and copying process is completed. So it's really helpful, and it's also useful when we are invoking df sort via iceman. So just take a look at this description of the sample bookstore dataset. Throughout this presentation, I've used some examples, and I'll use these field names for the file records that are part of those examples. This is just to get yourself familiarized. Yeah. So include and omit conditions. We can really need only a subset of records for processing, and using these include and omit statements, we can significantly increase the speed of sort, because whenever you are limiting the number of records you want to sort, you will increase the processing speed for df sort. And with these include omit conditions, we can also compare the fields among themselves or with a constant, or even we can test the field for a type of data that's actually numeric or packed decimal or floating point. And this just a key note here is that we cannot use both statements together. DF sort doesn't allow that. So this is example. This is a basic format of include or omit condition. We need to provide the starting location of the field that we need to compare, then the length of the field, format, and the comparison operator, and the next three fields can be for the field that we need to compare with, or it can be a constant. Like in this second example, you can see we are omitting, so this is department, by the way, in that bookstore dataset, and we are omitting the row records which have space in the department name. So, and before this will happen before the sorting process or the copy process is started. So the first one, if you can see, it's number of books sold and number of books in stock. So number of books in sold is greater than number of books in stock. So that means we need to include those records only. So these include and omit conditions can really help you to limit your input records. Also, we can do a data arithmetic within these include statements. For example, we have a 10-character date format and at the 42 position. So what we can do is this minus 30 and plus 30 means this date is between the 30 days in past and 30 days in future. So it really can provide you powerful capabilities. Okay, so the next example, we can, as I said, we can use this include or omit condition to check for the actual data type of the fields. So this this example will indicate if these fields at position for 22 and 28 are tagged in numerics. So this way we can eliminate the non-numerics and invalid tagged decimal from the input data set before the sorting process begins. Also, this last example, we can use the substring search capabilities of include and omit. We can do a substring search in that, like at this level, we have the department name. So it can be biology, history, business, or psychology. And we can include only those records which belong to these departments using a single include condition. So we have limited scope of the sort. Sorry? Which one? This one?
So, in all the statements.
Same file, different position of the record.
The same file,
yes.
Same row.
Yes. So these are the same record, same fields in that record, and this one is compared with a constant. So next one is the sum statement. In this statement, we can just add numeric fields, which are called the summary fields, whenever the records have same control fields. So this is a really complex. So in simple words, we can say that we need to sum records based on some duplicate criteria. That means the control fields. And we can only sum up numeric data, that means binary, fixed point, packed decimal, and zoned and floating point. We just need to take care of the overflow. If overflow occurs, then we do not change anything and the records are kept unchanged. So we just need to keep in mind that. Just keep in mind that whenever you are using sum statement, there are two kinds of fields involved. One is the summary field and one is the control field. All the records which are summed have the same control field. That means they are duplicate. And all the summary fields, that means all the numeric fields will be added up whichever you specify. I'll just show you an example. Suppose English, there's an English department in that bookstore data set. And they want to know the complete book dollar amount for all the books. So we can use an include condition to include only the English department books. And then whenever this English department books, so whenever department is English, so this means this is same for all the records, all the dollar amount of the book will be added. So we'll get the dollar amount for English department books. Likewise, we can add multiple fields as well. We can specify number of books or number of books in stock. And there's an interesting concept, sum fields equal to none. So whenever we are using sum fields equal to none, we will be eliminating all the duplicates at this position. So because we are not summing anything, or suppose we have 10 records which have the same value at this position, we will keep only the first one and rest 9 are discarded. So because we are not summing anything. So this way we can eliminate the duplicates. Yeah?
In the first example there, is the second line not redundant? If you're only pulling out characters 175 that equal one thing, sort of seems a bit pointless if they're all exactly the same value.
Yes, exactly. But for some fields, we need to provide this control fields that is mandatory. So that's why I know once we include this include condition, all the records will be in English. So there's no point, but control fields are necessary to be put when you're using some fields.
At the same time, if you do sorting, file is sorted. So I guess the sort will be doing the sorting first and then doing the sum.
Actually, sort in this case, sort will not do anything because all the records are English and we are sorting based on the same field. So there's nothing to sort. And because if even if there are 10 records with English department, every record will have EMGL at this position. So there's nothing much to sort. Yeah?
So that first one, you only get one record out of that.
Yes, exactly.
So that's what the sort field
is. Yes, yes. So you'll get the first record, and the dollar amount of all the books will be added in the specified column at 170.
Where do we use this sum in the same JCF or?
In the same, yeah, I can show you. Yeah. So. In all the control statements will go, all the examples in these control statements will go in SysLMDB. So along with sort fields, you can add some fields equal to whatever you want to provide.
Does it go to the output data set?
Yes, yes.
Well, just wanted to mention, if you can try and repeat the question I just said.
Okay, yeah. Next one are the outrec and inrec control statements. So with these statements, we can reformat the fixed fields and the variable field records. So for the fixed fields, we'll have fields starting at the same position every time and have a constant length. And while sorting and merging, we can do a variety of other stuff with this outrec and inrec. We can delete or reorder the fields and insert separators like blanks or strings and current date. So this example can be used to prevent the overflow or when the sum field, when we are using sum fields. Suppose we know that while summing the fields, the overflow can occur. So we can use the inrec. So before the sorting process begins, I can add a zero in front of that field just to make it bigger and then do the sum field so that overflow doesn't occur. And then we can use numeric values, arithmetic and the date arithmetic, and we can convert those numeric fields to the printable format using edit patterns and stuff. We can use these statements together, so it's not like include and omit that we cannot use them together because they don't have a relation. Inrec will reformat the records before the sorting processes begin, and outrec will do the processing after the sorting process is done. There are three ways in which we can build the records using outrec and inrec. First is the build word, where we have the control over each of the record and each of the byte as well. We can reformat it by in any form, any order we want, and also the overlay lets you change the fields at specific columns and without touching anything else on that record. So with if then we can also use build or overlay if we need to provide reformatting for different kinds of records in different manner. So we can use if-then clause. Yeah. Okay, so this is an example of outrec fields. This is the same example that I covered in the previous slide where we were just displaying, adding the number of books sold and number of books in stock. Now this additional statement will just display these three fields in the output data set, not the whole record. So with outrec, we can limit the information that we need to provide in the output report. Similarly, in this example, what we are doing is we are just using the input data set from first to 80 column and then just adding a timestamp with date and time and in front of it every record. The third example, we are just displaying a basic report where we just publishing with we are publishing the publisher name and the author name, and the last one we are just sorting based on two fields. This is the I guess this is department name and this is the dollar amount. So we are just displaying every department's total dollar amount instead of only one that we did earlier in like in the English department. So with this, we are including all the departments and then we are adding the dollar amount for the books. So we'll have one record for each department and the total dollar amount for the books. So this is a outfill statement, outfile, where we can once all the sorting process and outrec processing is done, we can add the outfill statement and do more processing on the output dataset at the dataset level. So all these verbs for DF sort, like include, omit, can be used at the outfile level, and it can be different outfill. Control statement can have different include and omit conditions. So we can do the processing as we want. So it really helps you to provide multiple output files over a single pass over input data set. This is an example where we are just copying the input data set on the local site. Suppose we want to take a local backup on the disk, and then also we simultaneously we want to take a backup on the remote sites on the tape. So we can do it in a single outfile statement where we can just provide outfile file names, backup, New York and San Jose, so that all the files will be having a backup at the local level and also at the remote level. We can use, instead of F names, we can use also the files word in outfile, where we just need to provide the numbers of the output files instead of the full name. And then we can use different include conditions on different output files. So within a single pass to DF sort, we can create three output files for each department. Symbols. So a symbol is basically a field name that you can use to define a constant or even a particular field at particular position. With this we can convert it into a high level language and do the programming in that way. And also once you define the mappings, you can use it anywhere in any other DF sort job as well. Once you define your input file mapping, so this makes it easier. We need to provide the mapping in sim names dataset. For this dataset, I provided a title from 1 to 75 column. And then we can use asterisks, which means that it will immediately follow the previous field. And we don't need to provide the exact starting column for the subsequent fields. So this simout dataset will have the exact symbol table, which DFSort will calculate for us, all the starting columns for all the fields and all the ending column and the field length. There are some limitations for DFSort. We need to adjust our control statements accordingly for variable length and fixed length records. We need to add 4 for a record descriptor word for variable record length. And these are some record length limitations for different file types. A key thing to note here is to keep in mind that DFSort truncates the fixed length records if the output dataset has a smaller record length. So it will truncate on the right. And also it doesn't pad with spaces on the right when it is larger. It will pad it with binary zeros in the output file whenever there's a sort out record length is larger than the sort in. So let's move on to the IceTool utility. So with IceTool, we can really use the DF sort capabilities by performing multiple operations on multiple input files and also giving multiple output files in a single job step. We IceTool has 17 operators, but we'll have a look at some of them, which are used most frequently. And we can also use it for providing reporting data and statistical analysis data. Like we can use the arithmetic functions, min, max, or average, and stuff like that to provide in the output report. This is a sample IceTool JCL. Job in exec statement. Now the exec statement will have ice program equal to IceTool, which will tell the operating system that we need to invoke the IceTool program. And this tool message and DF message will have the DF sort and the IceTool messages respectively. And we need to provide the IceTool statements in the tooling PD, where all the IceTool operators will go, and the DF sort control statement, which we learned earlier, we will go into the CNTL control datasets. And we can have multiple input data sets and output data sets. I'll just show you an example. Okay, so these are the 17 operators, and these are the most frequently used ones. So we'll cover one by one. So for every operator, DF sort will be called at the backend, and this copy operator will copy from the input dataset to the output dataset using a control statement, which will be a DF sort control statement. So you can see we can provide multiple DF sort control statements and multiple IceTool statements in single job step, and it will perform all the processing accordingly. We can also, there's an alternative approach for the same JCL. What we can do is a single copy statement and multiple outfill statements, like we had a look at earlier, where we can use three file names separately and three include conditions. So this, the only difference between these two copy statements and this single copy statement is, this copy statement will have a single call to DF sort in the backend, and these two copy statements will have two calls to DF sort, one for each copy statement. So whenever you are trying to improve your efficiency of the application, then you can consider these things handy. The next one is the sort operator, which will sort the input data sets to give multiple output data sets. We can use it in the similar way as we use the copy operators, like two sort statements or one sort statement with multiple out file statements. So it's really same type of control statement that we used with DF sort, but we can work on multiple input data sets at a time. The next one is a display operator, which will print the values of specified numeric fields. We can, in this example, you can see we are displaying the record number and then the characters from 40 to 51 here, and then 20 to 27, where all the on verbs will have fields in the output data set, and this list word will have the output file name field. So in the fields output file, we'll have the record from source and the record number and the field from 40th position to 51 and then from 20th to 27. These all are displayed in the standard display format when you're using the display operator. Next one is occur, where we can count the number of records for each unique key value which we can specify. So in the occur statement, wherever you will have the on word, this will become a joint key, complex key, where whenever this key is equal, the records will be summed, like Alabama 1. Well, there were 12 records for Alabama and 1. This is a single key, and we can add up and display the report. Also, we can display a title and page number and with every record. So this this record number, this record count is counts all the occurrences where Alabama and 1 are having the same value in all the input file. Next one is ICETOOL operator mode. We can use scan, stop, or continue mode with different ICETOOL verbs. And this will have different meaning. Whenever we are doing a scan mode, we'll never call df sort at all. We'll just check for the syntax errors from the range and unique words, and nothing will be processed. When we are doing the stop mode, we will stop the processing of display when there's a return code of 12 or 16 from verify. Verify does the checking for valid back decimal values in the input data set. And the last mode is the continue mode, where we continue even if we receive a return code of 12 or 16 from copy or sort or stats. So this is the last ICETOOL operator, which is most commonly used. This is the count, where we can specify the count of records in an input data set. We can add a text to it, like this example. This will count from the input file and write to a C3 file where with digits 6, and it will subtract 2. We can add or subtract value based on our need. So in this example, this input file has 8125 records, so that's why we are printing 8123. Now we're subtracting 2 from it. So we can define the number of bytes of the count that we need to provide accordingly. So let's move on to the application programming basics. Do you have any questions with ICETOOL or DFSort? So this is an example how we can invoke it from a COBOL program rather than invoking it directly. So we just can provide the optional control statement for include and then use the sort verb from COBOL, which will actually call DFSort in the background. And it will sort the input master file to the sorted master file. And we need to define this layout for input master file and sort file in the COBOL program, like we did it for symbols. There's some tips and tricks for improving efficiency when it comes to calling it from a program. Try to invoke it directly, like from JCL itself, if possible. And also, one thing that needs to be spot on is the information that we provide to DFSort. We need to provide the input data sets, input and output data set characteristics accurately. Otherwise, the DSSort will make assumptions and it can degrade the performance and also result in program termination or application degradation. Also, we need to take care of some fields, mainly where we can sum only the numeric fields, and providing invalid fields can result in incorrect output and also failure of DSSort job. Let's move on to some examples. I'll show you the examples and then we can move on to our mainframe to I'll show you a demo. So this is the way how we can keep the duplicate records when we are instead of discarding all the records. Like if we have 10 duplicate records for the same control field, we can keep the first one and discard the rest of them, but we can save them in a discard data set. I'll just show you. Okay, so this example will show you how to keep the discarded duplicate records. As you can see, we'll have two duplicate records for every control field. So this is the control field, which is position 1 and 3 length. So J43, N72, and A52. So these three records should be the unique ones, and everything else should be discarded into a separate data set. So I'll just run it. Okay, so this is the output data set where we got the, these are the records which are not discarded, and then the next one where X sum, these are the ones which are discarded. For M72 had 3 records, so the record 2 and 3 are discarded after sorting. So if you notice that earlier the records were not sorted, so first it was sorted, and then the first record was kept and the rest of them were discarded. Next example, we can use the translation feature in dfsort, where we can replace every byte as per our need. Suppose we need to change all the low values to space in a fixed block data set with record length of 60. Now we can define the alteration sequence where 00 will be replaced to 40, that is space, and throughout the data set. Also, instead of doing it throughout the data set, we can do it at a field level. Suppose we just need to keep the field, the packed decimal field unchanged, and rest all of the record can be translated using this alteration sequence. Then we can use outrec in this manner, where we will define this translation sequence for only the fields that we want to change. In this example, what we are doing is changing all the a to b and small x to small y. So this is the input data set, where so it should be changed to by and so and similarly the other two records as well. So I'll just run it and show you. These are the dfsort messages while processing. So this is the output data set now. All the AX are changed to BY in the first record, and we can change it accordingly to our need. If you want to change the data at the byte level. So this feature is really helpful. The next example is we can use dfsort to sample the records. Suppose there are million records in the input data set, then we can sample it based on our own sampling interval, and we can display only 100, 200, and 300 records as per our need if we need to check for anomalies in the input data set. So as you can see, I've marked every 100 record as record 100, then record 200 and like that. And if I run this job, then I'll see only 5 records that are displayed. My sampling interval is 100. So I'm just displaying those 5 records output and output data set from those 500 input data set records. Also, we can use some same example as squeezing out the input data set file records, where we can squeeze out the blanks or any other characters that we want. So this input data set has record length of 48, 16 each, and then we are trimming out the spaces in between these names. So we can achieve that based on the squeeze parameter of dfsort. That's really a nice feature of dfsort. This example is useful when we want to split our big input file into multiple output files based on a count interval. So this split 1 hour interval can be defined as per your need. I define it as 4 in this case. So after every four records, the output data set will change. So first four sorted records will go to output data set one, and then the next four sorted records will go to output data set two. And since I don't have any more output data sets, so rest all the records will go to the output data set three, even if it is more than four. I'll show you an example. I have 14 records in this input data set. So I'm expecting the first four records in one, second four in two, and last six in the third data set. So these are the first four sorted records, and then the second four, and the last six records are in the output data set three, since I don't have any more output data sets. We can use the data type search capabilities in the include or omit condition, where we can check for specific field types. Like we can check at this column if the field has numeric values or both alphanumeric values. So if this is the file type, input file, all the numeric records will be kept because we are including only the numeric ones, and all these alphanumeric ones will be discarded. And the last example will be the most commonly used one, where we can use the FTOV or VTOF parameter of DFSort by converting the fixed block file to variable length file, and then the variable to fixed length, and vice versa. So this is really helpful, but what we need to make sure is we need to build our own output record in when we are converting it from variable block to fixed block, because we know that the data will begin at position 5 after the record descriptor word of 4 bytes in the variable block length. I'll show you the file outputs. This is the fixed block input file that I gave, which has a length record length of 75, and the output variable block file had a length of 79, including the 4 byte record descriptor word when I ran this job. And when I gave the input variable block file for 79, same 79 length, then the input record that came out to be fixed block 75. So because I built it from a length position 5. So any questions?
When you convert from a variable block to a fixed block,
yes, they're gone. Okay, so if I understand correctly, your question was when we are converting from variable block to fixed block, the 4 bytes from the record descriptor word are gone or are saved somewhere, right?
Yeah, so when you don't solve it for account for replacing them.
Yeah. Yeah, they are just discarded, and there is nothing in the output fixed block file. Any other questions? Thank you.
No, great. Thank you very much.